So the last talk of this session is about improved higher order conversion from Boolean to arithmetic masking from Luc Bétal, Jean-Sébastien Coron, and Rina Zetoun. And Jean-Sébastien will give the talk.
Okay, thank you, Sonia. So in this talk, I'm going to describe a new higher order conversion algorithm from Boolean to arithmetic masking. So first, I'm going to recall what is this classical masking countermeasure. So I think it should be pretty clear now. So in the masking countermeasure, if we have, instead of processing some variable x, any variable x in a block cipher, we are going to mask x with a random or, and we process only the masked variable x prime, which is x XOR or. So now, since or is random, x prime is also random, so the power consumption of x prime is going to be random, and then no information about x is leaked. So that's the masking countermeasure. But some algorithms combine Boolean and arithmetic operations, for example, HMAC SHA-1. So in that case, for these algorithms, we would like to use also arithmetic masking, in which similarly, the original variable x is shared between two arithmetic masks, A and R, modulo 2 to k, where k is the size of the registers. And then we should manipulate A and R separately. So now, if we have an algorithm that combines Boolean and arithmetic operation, the question is, how do we convert between Boolean and arithmetic masking? So at chess 01, Goubin described the first conversion algorithm between Boolean and arithmetic masking, and it is secure at first order, so secure against first order attacks. But of course, we know that it's possible to mount second order attacks in which we combine the information from the masked value and the random OR. And so this second order attack requires more traces, but it can be practical. So a natural solution to prevent second order attacks is to use high order masking. So instead of having two shares, we split the original variable x into n shares, n Boolean shares, x1 to xn. And now, if we ensure that any subset of n-1 shares is uniformly and independently distributed, in that case, if we probe at most n-1 shares, then we learn nothing about x, because everything is uniformly distributed. So this means that the countermeasure is going to be secure against a DPA attack of order at most n-1. So now the problem is the following. We have this high-order Boolean masking, but for arithmetic operations, we would like to use high-order arithmetic masking, in which x is split into n arithmetic shares. So now the question is, how do we convert between high-order Boolean and high-order arithmetic masking? So in this talk, I'm going to describe a new high-order Boolean to arithmetic conversion algorithm. So we go from Boolean to arithmetic. And it is actually a variant of a countermeasure that was published at last CHESS. And so it's a simpler and slightly more efficient variant. So we will see that the complexity of the algorithm is independent of the register size k. So it's independent of k. And that's why the countermeasure is quite efficient in practice. And still, of course, we have a proof of security in the ISW probing model. So let me summarize the prior work. So I denote by n the number of shares and by k the size of the modulus. So for example, k equals 32 for HMAC SHA-1. So initially, we have Goubin's algorithm, which is secure at first order only. And from Boolean to arithmetic, the conversion is very efficient. It's constant time, actually. And from arithmetic to Boolean, it is a bit less efficient. The complexity is proportional to the size of the register, proportional to k. And then at chess 14, we published the first high-order algorithm to convert between Boolean and arithmetic masking, and the complexity was n squared times k in both directions. And so this complexity was slightly improved to big O of log k for first-order complexity instead of big O of k in the arithmetic to Boolean direction. And this translates to n squared log k instead of n squared times k in both directions. But actually, in practice, this does not really improve the running time, at least for k equals 32, because there is a bigger constant in front of the log k. So last year, I described a high-order Boolean to arithmetic conversion algorithm, where the complexity is independent of k, but the complexity is exponential in the number of shares n. But actually, in practice, for small values of n, the running time is actually much faster than from previous work. So it's only interesting for small values of n. And so in this talk, I'm going to describe a variant, a simplified variant of this quantum measure from last year, in which we slightly improve the running time by a constant factor. So if we plot the complexity, here we see that on the blue line, we are slightly better than the quantum measure from last year, the green line. And that's especially and then the complexity is much better for small values of n compared to the chess 14 quantum measure. But of course, here the complexity grows exponentially, so at some point it is better to use the chess 14 quantum measure. So let me compare with the quantum measure from last year. So we only gain roughly 25% in running time, but the reason we decided to write this paper and to publish this quantum measure is that it is simpler, it is a bit more elegant. There are fewer components in it, as I will explain. In particular, there are fewer mask refreshings. So the contribution is therefore the following. We described the simplified variant of the chess 2017 algorithm, and still, of course, with a proof of security in the ISW probing model. And this was actually an approach which was initiated by Hutter and Tunstall in some imprint paper, but actually they did not have a proof of security. So actually last year, I described a third order attack against their scheme for any number of shares, and this year we have also a third order attack against their updated algorithm. So let me recall quickly the security model. So we work in the ISW security model in which the adversary can have at most t probes, and then the proof is simulation based. That is, we prove that for any set of t probes, we can perfectly simulate those t probes from a subset of the input of the input shares of the secret key. And so if we can simulate everything from at most n minus 1 of the shares of the secret key, and if those shares are initially uniformly and independently distributed, this means that we can perfectly simulate those n minus 1 shares of the secret key, and therefore we can perfectly simulate the t-probes. And this means that the adversary learns nothing because he could perform this simulation by himself. So the main lesson from the past is to never publish a high-order masking scheme without a proof of security, because many things can go wrong, and we may have a poor intuition of high-order security. So let me describe the original Gubin's algorithm. So the original conversion algorithm from Gubin is based on this function psi, which is x xor or minus or modulo 2 to k. And it is based on the fact that this function is affine with respect to the second variable R over GF2. So this is surprising because the function combines one Boolean and arithmetic operation, but this is true. And then it's easy to describe the conversion algorithm. We start with the two shares x1 and x2. We subtract x2, and then we add x2. And this is, by definition, the psi function here. And then, thanks to the affine property of this psi function, we can write this as the XOR of two psi functions. And then we see that this left term can be computed without leaking information about x, thanks to this random OR. And so this implies that the function is going to be first-order secure. So here we get the sum of two arithmetic shares, A and x2, and A can be computed without knowing x, without leaking information about x. So our new algorithm is a generalization of Goubin. So we start with actually n plus 1 shares instead of n. So x is x1, the XOR of x1 to xn plus 1. Then artificially, we subtract x2 to xn plus 1, and then we add x2 to xn plus 1. So here, we recognize the definition of the psi function on the left side. And now, thanks to the affine property of this psi function, we can split this into n expressions of the psi function. And so here, we get the sum of two expressions which have both n Boolean shares instead of n plus 1 at the beginning. So we can now apply the algorithm recursively. And so we are going to apply the algorithm recursively. And so since we now have n shares, n Boolean shares as input, we are going to get n minus 1 arithmetic shares on both sides. So here, this gives n minus 1 arithmetic shares, and this gives n minus 1 arithmetic shares. So we get this. And now we can do some arithmetic grouping of the shares, and eventually we obtain n shares, n arithmetic shares as required. So we have a recursive algorithm that takes as input n plus 1 input shares, n plus 1 Boolean shares, and outputs n arithmetic shares. So here, this is actually an oversimplification because we need some intermediate mask refreshing. Otherwise, the quantum measure will be insecure. So we have a proof in the ISW probing model. Actually, we use these TNI and TSNI security definitions, which are very convenient for proving the security of a scheme because we can focus on each gadget separately, and then we use the composition property to argue about the security of the full scheme. So the proof is in the proceedings. And so for the operation count, we see that in the new quantum measure, we are slightly more efficient than the quantum measure from last year. And also, the quantum measure is much more efficient for small orders than the quantum measure from CHESS 2014. It is at least one order of magnitude more efficient. But this is true for small security orders because the complexity grows exponentially, so at some point, we are less efficient. So we have also performed a formal verification of the quantum measure. So for this, we have used the check mask tool that I have published this year. So it performs a generic verification of masking quantum measures. And it is based on the Common Lisp language, which is very well suited to formal manipulations. And then the source code to perform these formal verifications is quite short. So it's easy to verify the code is correct. And so the code is also public. So, but this is a generic verification, and we look at all possible subset of n minus 1 variables. So the complexity is exponential in n. And it's actually doubly exponential because the circuit size is also exponential in n. So that's why we could only perform this verification for small values of n, up to n equals 5. But still, this provides some confidence in the correctness of the security proof. So to conclude, so I have described a new higher-order Boolean to arithmetic conversion algorithm, which is simpler than the one from last year and a bit more efficient. So we still have a proof of security and a formal verification up to n equals 5. But the main drawback of the algorithm, of course, is that its complexity is exponential in the number of shares, but independent of k, the size of the register. So instead of n squared times k from chess 14, but we've seen that for small values of n, it is still much more efficient. So of course, the open problem is, can we do better than this exponential complexity? So thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have time for questions. I actually have a question. So in your proposal, you show how to perform a conversion from Boolean masking to arithmetic masking with a modulus which is a power of 2. Would your efficient proposals could they be applied to such a conversion with another kind of modulus, like a prime, for instance?
Yeah, it seems difficult to perform this conversion from prime modulus because here the conversion is based on the fact that this specific function is affine with respect to the second variable over GF2. So if you have a prime modulus here instead of 2 to k, then it's unlikely that you will have this affine property. So, okay. And then the algorithm is completely based on this affine property. So it seems difficult to extend this to prime modulus. Okay.
Questions? I have another very quick question. So you tested your method on small orders with the verification tool. For these kinds of order, can you have further optimizations? Like, can you use less random values because of the smaller orders?
Yes. So we could imagine to use fewer randomness. Yes. We didn't really try to optimize the amount of randomness, but certainly since the complexity is exponential, and it's certainly possible to reduce the amount of randomness. And indeed, you could verify this with the formal tool, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Let's thank the speaker again, and all the speakers of this session.